crushed from the inside out. How precious, how generous your blood poured out for us. How precious, how generous, we remember. You paid it in full, you paid it in blood, you paid it for us, Jesus.
great light dawns in Galilee.
Good morning. Good morning, church. It's great to see you here today on a beautiful Sunday. Thanks for being in God's house today. I want to start by reading a passage from Ephesians chapter 5. This is from the Apostle Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. And he says, "Be filled by the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making music with your hearts to the Lord, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." If you have ever wondered, whether you are brand new to the church or you've been coming to church your entire life, if you've ever wondered why we sing in church every week, verses like this are the exact reason why. Paul is saying here that for those who have a faith in Jesus and have received the Holy Spirit, what that looks like, evidence of being filled with the Holy Spirit, is singing songs together. So this morning, I want to encourage you, if you are somebody who doesn't normally sing, if you are somebody who maybe sings very quietly and does not like to be heard, if you are somebody who sings really loud, wherever you're at on the spectrum of singing in church, give it a shot today. Just sing with us, because not just because it's something fun that we do on a Sunday morning, but because it is scripture being acted out. This is one of the signs that we love Jesus. So I'm going to ask you to go ahead and stand as we start our service. We're going to sing some songs, some lively songs, and that's my ask. Just join in with us, participate in a way that might be uncomfortable for you, but let's do it anyway, because the Bible tells us to.
Rest on us, Spirit. Freedom I am. we're so thankful to be in your house this morning, to worship you, to lift up your name in the name of your Son, Jesus, Lord, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our risen Savior, and the one who will be returning for us. We are so thankful for who you are today and what you mean to each one of us. We just pray that as we continue in this service, that our hearts would be open to your Holy Spirit, that you would move in this place in each one of us, and let us not walk out the same way that we walked in. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Hey, thanks for joining us today. I'm Isaac. If I haven't gotten to meet you before, I'm the youth pastor and groups director here. And if you are new here, I just want you to know we exist for you. That we are passionately inviting ordinary people to live everyday life like Jesus for the good of the neighborhood. So if you're new, we would love just to know that you were here. You can grab one of those black cards in the pew in front of you, or in the basket underneath your seat, and just fill it out. And I would love to get to meet you after service. I have a small gift for you as well. Now, if you call this church your home, we invite you to continue worship through giving. There are four different ways you can give: online, by texting, physically through giving boxes, or by mail. And so much of what we do here is because you guys are all so financially generous to us. Well, take the next two minutes, greet somebody around you. In fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, you guys are dismissed to your classes. Take a seat. All right, I have one exciting thing to tell you. But first, I think I am mandated to give a shout out to my Northgate musical students. They did an awesome job this week. Yeah. They put on four amazing shows of SpongeBob the Musical. It was so funny. I might have lost a few brain cells, but that's what SpongeBob's for. But no, they did an awesome job. And you know, we got to host the cast party here last night, so it was just a lot of fun. I'm surprised I still have a voice, so we'll see what happens. I'm really just praying I don't have a cough attack during this, but we'll see what happens. But hey, one thing I really want to tell you guys about is our child dedication class. And this is a way for you to just thank God for the gift of your children and make a public commitment to raising your kids to follow Jesus. So if you've had a baby or so in the past year, or a toddler or somebody who you haven't dedicated to the Lord yet, this is just one way to just say, hey, I know I wasn't made to raise my kids alone. You will learn a lot of good things from this class. This class is going to be on Sunday, April 28th, directly after service. Childcare will be provided, and then on Mother's Day, May 12th, will be the actual child dedication service. You can sign up for this class at bellevuechristian.church/events. And it is led by one of my favorite people here, who also happens to be my wife. So I recommend going. She has a lot of good things to help out some new parents or some new babies. But with that, let's go ahead and prepare our hearts as we continue our series, This is Jesus. All right, two words that you might recognize, you might not. It's these two words, therefore, go. If you've been with us for a while, those two words, therefore, go, you have heard a countless amount of times. Therefore, go. Those are two words we say at the end of every service here at Bellevue Christian Church. If you're unfamiliar with those two words, those are some of Jesus' last words to those who followed him. Therefore, go summarizes what Jesus has commanded us to do. That is to therefore go and make disciples of all nations. Really, just say, hey, in your everyday life. Just tell people about Jesus. Tell other people about what Jesus has done in your life, and therefore go and tell them. But even though these are words we hear a lot, I wouldn't be surprised if these are words we tend to ignore a lot. I think even though we hear those two words every week, I think many of us, you know, myself included, that sometimes we get to a place where we don't bother to live out everything we hear. I feel like sometimes those two words, therefore go, they can be really exciting, can pump you up as like a Christian who is ready to share their faith. But other times, when you really think about it, it's a little bit scary. If I'm being honest, to go and actually tell other people about Jesus. I can't speak for everyone in the room, but I know I have countless amount of stories in my own personal life where I know I should be telling this person about Jesus, whether it's somebody who's next to me on an airplane, that I put headphones on so I don't have to talk to them, or if it's just somebody I see every day, like a coworker or friend, that I know I should be telling them about Jesus, but then I just get paralyzed with fear. I start to worry, like, what if I don't know what to say? What if I don't say it well enough? I'm scared that I'm going to get rejected. What if this person just starts hating me because of it? What if they don't want to be my friend? What if they always avoid me now? Or what if I actually go out on a limb, tell them about Jesus, but it turns them away from Jesus? Now, those are just a little glimpse of different fears and emotions I sometimes have. When it's centered around sharing my faith, you know, telling people about Jesus, inviting them to church or Alpha, and I'm I'm just going to go out on a limb and say that I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one here who have experienced something like that. And I'm sure many of us who would call ourselves Christians, that we have stories of when we wished we shared our faith, that we see our missed opportunities because fear and worry and anxiety seized us, that we're trying to work up the courage, that we're having a good chat with somebody we love or care about or at least somebody we know. We're trying to work up the courage, trying to guide the conversation to get to Jesus, or at least mention I go to church, or at least mention I listen to Caleb. Just like any little snapshot that I can just say, I follow Jesus. But, you know, it's hard. It's difficult. You know, our heart starts beating faster. I don't know why, but even given announcements, I'm like, why is my heart beating faster? I'm just talking about child dedication. And that's nowhere near as scary as telling somebody who doesn't know Jesus about him. You know, our hearts beat faster. Our hands get sweaty. Something about my mom's spaghetti, but sorry, I had to say that. But we want to share, but then we just don't. We just don't do it. And we're in this place of fear. The all these fears just paralyze us and get us in the way of telling the world about Jesus. So when it feels like it depends on us, we have a hard time doing it. When it feels like somebody else's faith or salvation depends on us, we have a hard, difficult time going and telling the world about Jesus. And it really stops us from living the life that Jesus made for us. So in today's passage, I think God is going to reveal three ways that he can move us from a place of fear to a place of faithfully sharing the gospel. Three ways that God can work in our lives to move us from fear to faithfully sharing the gospel with courage and boldness. I think this passage also speaks to anyone here who is exploring faith. And maybe you wouldn't call yourself a Christian. Maybe you're just trying this church thing out. And you're like, you know, I obviously don't care about sharing the gospel. I don't even know if this is true. I think this passage is going to show you something too, because we're going to see how Jesus interacts with people who are unsure about him as well. So if you are exploring faith, this is a great place for you to be as well. Today we're going to be in Luke chapter 24 verses 36 to 49. This is good. Believe it or not, this is the second to last episode of this is Jesus. We are finally nearing the finish line of this is Jesus. So you can turn there in your Bibles. You can open it up on your phones. It's also all going to be on the screen behind me as well. Luke chapter 24 verses 36 to 49. You see, we pick up the story here with the disciples in a state very similar to what I just described. That in their minds, or you know, all they know now is the person, Jesus, that they dedicated the last 3 years of their life to, of their time and their hope to, was just killed. They thought this person that was going to save them was just killed. And then even though, you know, even though many of us know now that, you know, and we believe that Jesus rose from the grave, the disciples right now, they haven't connected the dots yet. All they know is this person that gave me hope, this person that I rearranged my life for, is gone. And what if everything he taught wasn't worth it? What if everything he taught wasn't true? They're starting to think, maybe I placed my hope in the wrong person. They're not even thinking about him coming back. They were without hope for a future, and they were scared. The disciples were scared at this point. The Gospel of John tells the same story, but he points out the detail that the disciples locked themselves in this room because they were scared of the Jewish leaders, that that they made sure they had the doors locked because they didn't want the Jewish leaders finding them, because they were done sharing about Jesus. They were done because they were afraid that if they got caught as somebody who followed Jesus, or as somebody who was teaching things that Jesus taught or teaching about Jesus, that they would be arrested, beaten, and killed just like him. So they are absolutely done sharing about Jesus. But now these disciples, they're starting to hear claims that he rose from the grave. They haven't seen him yet personally, but they're starting to hear these claims from different people. They're hearing claims from the woman at the tomb who had an encounter with an angel, who had an encounter with Jesus himself. And they start to hear it from the disciples we met last week who were traveling to Emmaus, who personally met Jesus. They're starting to hear these claims, but they don't know if it's true. They still have lots of doubts and lots of disbelief. This is all happening where they're locked in this room, afraid of what was going on. They've given up on sharing Jesus. I think the crazy thing is that at this point in time, they're way over here. They're scared and everything, given up on sharing Jesus. But when we continue reading the Bible and other historical records, we see that they're in a completely different place. That somehow the disciples go from being scared to having tremendous courage and faith. That these same people go on to share the gospel boldly to as much of the world as they can. They share the gospel about Jesus across multiple continents. That they're willing to be arrested, beaten, and even killed for Jesus at some point in their life. But right now, they're not there yet. And my question is, what happened in the middle right here? How did these ordinary people move from a place of fear to a place of faithfully sharing the gospel? What happened? Because it doesn't make sense. How were they so scared and hiding to be willing to give up everything for Jesus? What happened in the middle here? And I think this passage is going to reveal three ways that God moved them from fear to faithfulness, and they're the same three ways that he can move us from fear to faithfulness as well. And it all starts, the first way it starts with is with a personal encounter with a risen Jesus. A personal encounter with a risen Jesus. They needed to not just hear about Jesus, but they needed to experience him personally. So let's pick it up from verse 36. As the disciples were saying these things, he himself stood in their midst. He said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. Why are you troubled? Jesus asked them. Why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. That is I myself. Touch me and see, because a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you can see I have. Having said this, he showed them his hands and feet. But while they were still amazed and in disbelief because of their joy, he asked them, "Do you have anything to eat?" So they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. So right away, we learned that Jesus liked seafood. I don't, so that's one way I can't be like Jesus, but that's okay. But more importantly, out of nowhere, Jesus appears in this room, doors locked to make sure nobody can get in. But Jesus, he just demonstrates his power, and he just shows up in this room. And I don't know, maybe that points to something greater, that no matter what barrier and doubts you have about Jesus, he still has the power to show up with whatever barriers, disbelief, and doubts you have. But the disciples, they were already scared, and now they're scared even more. Even though the woman and the Emmaus disciples told the rest of them that Jesus has risen from the grave, they were still in disbelief. They had their doubts. And their first thought wasn't that Jesus did the impossible. They weren't trying to scheme up, like, how can we convince the world that Jesus rose from the grave when he was actually dead? That's not what they were thinking. It was too beyond their imagination that it was more likely that Jesus was a ghost to them. They're like, that was their first thought, that if Jesus is here, he's not really here. It's just a spirit or ghost or something. But then Jesus meets them and say, no, I'm really here. You did see me die 3 days ago, but I've risen from the grave to prove the power I have over sin and death. If you don't believe me just by seeing, you can touch me. You can touch my wounds. I'll even eat in front of you to prove that I'm not a ghost, but I'm physically, bodily resurrected. And this encounter with Jesus was the start of them realizing who Jesus really was. I'm sure it didn't answer all of their questions, but at the very least, it started to turn the wheels in their head. And we're seeing them move from a place of no way he's alive. These women, these other disciples just making it up, to go into a place, what if he is? What if Jesus is doing something miraculous here? What if there's more to Jesus than I expected? It all starts with a personal encounter. But the disciples also needed something else, and it's something that we need too. And the second way that God moves us from fear to faithfulness is through a revelation of the scriptures. It's through a revelation of the scriptures. By that word revelation, I mean that the disciples needed God to shine a light on what God's word really said. Or another way to describe it, that God needed to pull back the curtain and reveal what the scriptures really mean. Because the disciples thought they knew the scriptures, and you know, in our mind today, they're talking about what we call today the Old Testament. They thought they knew what the scriptures said about the coming Messiah, but they were so wrong. And it's funny because a lot of them probably studied the scriptures growing up for years of their life. I'm sure they had many parts of it memorized, but even though they had all that head knowledge, they still didn't truly understand what the scriptures were saying until Jesus gave them a revelation of what was really happening, or how Luke puts it, until Jesus opened up their mind. To continue reading what Luke wrote, it said, Jesus told them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything was written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened up their minds to understand the scriptures. Honestly, my favorite verse of this whole passage is verse 45. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. Because all throughout Luke, we see time after time, Jesus says, hey, the Messiah, me, I'm going to die, be raised from the dead. And it's always followed. But they did not understand. I think one time it might have even said that they were prevented from understanding. But all of a sudden, God gives them the ability to understand what was really happening. Jesus opens up their minds to understand that everything in the Old Testament points to Jesus, that he is the Messiah that they've been waiting for, that he's the Savior that they've written Psalms about, that he's the Savior of the world that prophets have been speaking about, that they've been waiting centuries for. That it is Jesus, and it didn't get ruined when he was nailed to the cross, because that was God's plan all along. We just didn't know it. That the Messiah needed to suffer on the cross to pay for our sins, but he would be raised 3 days later. And as he's teaching these things for the very first time, the disciples' minds are open to understand what is happening, that for some reason they didn't get what was happening in Scripture, but now for the first time they understand what is happening. I've used this illustration before, but since we've been in Luke for about a decade, I think I can bring it back. I imagine that the disciples were reading the Scriptures, but their mind was dark. It's kind of like this picture right here. I mean, this is just a random picture from Google, and I just edited it to be as dark as I could make it. And if you were going to try to describe this picture right here, you would have a very challenging time, because you can't see much. So, you know, it looks like there's something in the top middle. It looks like a tree, but I really can't see anything else. And I feel like that's how the disciples were reading the Scriptures. They saw the words, but they didn't grasp the meaning. They could only see a little bit. They couldn't see it all until Jesus shined a light on it. Because when we shine a light on this picture, again, the same exact picture, we just put more light to it, we have a much fuller understanding of what's happening. It's not just a few branches or one tree, but it's this beautiful, beautiful picture of this nature scene. There's trees all around. There's this river or stream flowing through. There's rocks alongside of it, and there's so much more here that we couldn't see before. Because without light, we don't get this beautiful picture. Likewise, without Jesus shining a light onto Scripture, we don't get the real meaning of the text. You know, Jesus isn't changing what the Old Testament says, but he's revealing what it has meant all along. Again, every single book of the Old Testament is meant to point us to Jesus, to point us to this Jewish Messiah who lived a sinless life, who died on the cross for our sins, who was raised 3 days later so that we could follow him and experience real love and real life and a real relationship with the God that we were made for. And we can't know that, we can't experience it, we can't share that without God shining a light onto Scripture for us. The theological term for this is illumination. That God is illuminating our mind to understand the Scripture so that we can truly understand who Jesus is and why he matters. So after Jesus has an encounter with his disciples, after he opens up their minds to understand the Scriptures, and before he gives us the third way, that he moves us from fear to faithfulness, he gives them and us their mission, our mission. In verse 46, it says, Jesus also said to them, "This is what is written: Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning at Jerusalem." So that's the good news. That's everything Jesus came to do and what he did do. Then it says, "You are my witnesses to these things." You are my witnesses to these things. And this is Luke's version of the Great Commission. You know, usually we read the version from Matthew that says that therefore go and make disciples of all nations. But this is Luke's version. It says, you are witnesses to these things. As in, you have a duty to go and tell others what you have saw or what you have seen, what you have experienced. Because you guys walked with me. You guys have heard my teaching. You guys saw me die to pay the price for your sin. And you also saw that I rose from the grave. You see the real meaning of the Scriptures now. And you need to take that and tell that to other people. You are my witnesses to the rest of the world. Because what you know, what you've experienced is life-changing, and the rest of the world needs to know. You know what the best part is? It's this third thing that's coming up, is that Jesus isn't expecting us to go and be witnesses on our own. Instead, he says, and look, I am sending you what my Father promised. As for you, stay in the city until you are empowered from on high. And what did God promise all the way back in the Old Testament? Then Jesus promises again here. He promises to give us himself. He promises to give us the Holy Spirit and power from the Holy Spirit. This Holy Spirit that Jesus sends us, the Holy Spirit to empower us. That the Holy Spirit is God's personal power and presence that he pours out onto those who follow him. And what I love about this is that God isn't expecting you to be witnesses and just muster up the guts on your own strength. He isn't expecting you to craft this perfectly worded argument. He isn't expecting you to somehow just find the courage and bravery on your own, but instead, he's inviting you to lean into the power of the Holy Spirit, to not rely on our own human power that's very weak and small when we think about it, and it fails us time and time again, but to instead rely on the power that comes from God himself, from the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the one that gives us courage when we're scared out of our minds. He's the one that gives us strength and who gives us peace and wisdom. He's the one who gives us a burdened heart. So maybe you're somebody here and you're like, I'm not scared to share the gospel. I just don't care about it, if I'm being honest. I like keeping it to me. The Holy Spirit can also give you a heart, start to change your hearts so that you're burdened for your friends and family and neighbors. We're called to be faithful and share the good news about Jesus, but there's not a lot comes from our human power, because the real power is in how the Holy Spirit meets and works within you as you share, and with it and within the person you are sharing to. Listen to these words from the Apostle Paul. These are some of my favorite Bible verses of all time. Says, when I came to you, brothers and sisters, announcing the mystery of God to you, I did not come with brilliance of speech or wisdom. I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I came to you in weakness, in fear, in much trembling. My speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power. Let me say that again. I came to you weakness and fear and in trembling, but it was with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not be based on human wisdom, but on God's power. That our fears and weaknesses, that it's okay to have them, because we see the Apostle Paul right here who spread the gospel to much of the known world at the time. That he had them too, but what he did, that he didn't just keep those fears to himself, but he brought it to God. That our fears and weaknesses should push us to rely greater on the power of the Holy Spirit. But whatever fears you have, if you're afraid that you don't have the right words, if you're afraid that you don't have the right relationships, if you're afraid that you don't know how to say it, if you're afraid that this will ruin the relationship you have, if it will ruin your workplace reputation, if any fear you have, you can fill in the blank if I didn't say the fear you have. It says, don't let that paralyze you, but let that push you into a deeper prayer life of relying on the Holy Spirit. Because the same power that rose Jesus from the grave now lives inside everyone who believes in Jesus. That these disciples, they're understanding the scripture. And when Jesus is saying, hey, I'm going to give you what my Father promised, they are connecting dots left and right. And they are moving from being fearful to say, man, if God was able to raise Jesus from the dead, surely He can give me the courage and boldness to faithfully share about him. And all we have to do is ask the Holy Spirit to fill us up. So just to recap, there are three ways we see Jesus move the disciples from fear to faithfulness. One, they have a personal encounter with Jesus. That's what some of us need first. That we hear these stories about Jesus, but we haven't experienced him. And the great news that is through the Holy Spirit, you can still have an encounter with Jesus. And if you are somebody who's exploring faith, maybe you feel like you're in a really dry season as a Christian, maybe you're deconstructing some, all you have to do is say, Holy Spirit, can you show me if you're real? Can you just, I'm desperate to know if you're real. Can you show up in my life? All you have to do is ask for the Holy Spirit. And then next, they had a revelation about the scripture. Again, and if you're somebody who you're reading the Bible and it just isn't making sense, or maybe you're just showing up and a lot of these messages just aren't making sense to you, you can say, Jesus or Holy Spirit, can you show me what this means? Can you help me connect the dots? God, if you're real, can you work in my life? And then lastly, we can pray to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. Maybe you're, I know Jesus is real. I understand what the Bible is saying, but man, I'm just still fearful. I don't know if it's worth it to share about the gospel. I just don't know. But you can say, Holy Spirit, give me the power to share about you, because I recognize my human strength, my human power is not enough. So, I invite you today, whichever one you resonate with most, whether it's one, two, or all three of them, just start to pray. Start to pray for the Holy Spirit to fill you up. Because again, these disciples, they were full of doubts. They were done sharing about Jesus, just like some of us are in this room right now. They were done sharing about Jesus. It wasn't worth it. They were hiding, scared away. But they were the same people that God encountered, that God gave a revelation to and God empowered and used to spread his gospel in the first century. Empowered by the Holy Spirit, they went on to teach from the scriptures and share what they witnessed. And the Bible says that day after day, the number of those being saved was tremendous. And God's work isn't done yet. That's the probably biggest thing I want you to know, is that God's work isn't done yet. He wants to use you and me, and he's showing us who he is today. He's opening up our eyes to understand what's happening, and he is empowering us. That there are people that we have relationships with, people who are our family, people who are our coworkers, people we go to school with, that they're trying to find faith and hope, they're trying to find love, they're trying to find purpose in all of the wrong places, and it just isn't working. They have this cry for this inner turmoil they have, but they don't know what the real answer is. And that's where you come in. That's how the Holy Spirit wants to use you, to share this message of hope that is in Jesus. That even if you feel weak, even if you feel fearful, the power of the Holy Spirit, Bellevue and Avalon can be changed. Westview, Brighton Heights, Emsworth, Ben Avon, any neighborhood in Pittsburgh, or wherever you find yourself, can be changed, and it's through this message of Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, I don't know where each person in this room is coming from, God, but what I do know, that each one of us needs you. Holy Spirit, I pray that you fill us up, God. Lord, so many of us just are in these situations that we're in these relationships that you have ordained us to be in, but we're having a hard time moving out of fear and into faithfulness, God, of sharing what you've done, God. And I just want to say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, fill us up. Holy Spirit, give us people that our hearts are burdened to know you. Holy Spirit, we want a demonstration of your power in the relationships we find ourselves in. Holy Spirit, we want you to move and work. God, show us who you are in our own lives, God. Give us confidence of who you are, even if we don't understand every single thing about you, God. Give us confidence that you are good, that you are loving, that you are worthy, God. And help us share this message with those you have placed in our lives. Jesus, we need you. Holy Spirit, come. Amen.
We're going to move now into our time of communion. If you did not get communion on your way in and you need it, there are baskets in the front and in the back. Feel free to go get a cup. The Last Supper that Jesus had with his disciples, the night of Passover, before he was arrested and crucified, he celebrated this meal with them, and this was certainly something that they didn't understand in the same light when it was first happening. As Isaac talks about, after Jesus and the Holy Spirit opened their minds to Scripture and understanding, the pieces of the puzzle start coming together. It's confusing when Jesus is telling his disciples, this is my body and my blood that's going to be broken and poured out for you. And they're not expecting him to die. They're expecting him to be a reigning king who's going to come into his kingdom. But we see now the church for almost 2,000 years now has understood the significance of this, and that's why we celebrate this. The Apostle Paul, in that same letter that Isaac talked about, we call it 1 Corinthians, he described communion this way. He says, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night which he was being betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. Go ahead and participate in the elements. And I want you to just take a moment as you do to think about what it means that this is a way that Jesus is saying he's done this for us, and that as often as we do it, we're to remember him. This is one of those encounters that Isaac alluded to with Jesus that we get to have on a weekly basis here at our church. Just think about that, pray on that, meditate on that. Into a time of singing with a song that Justin introduced last week called Holy Ground, and it's all about what happens when we encounter Jesus, what it's like to meet him, to see him, to be changed by him. If you're having a moment with Jesus this morning, you have the freedom to sit, to stand, to kneel, to pray, to sing. However it is that you need to see Jesus this morning and hear from him, more importantly, and talk to him, do that. Do that during this time. Debbie's going to lead us into this song in a moment. Just keep meditating on what it's like to encounter Jesus.
As we sing this next part, just believe the words that you're saying. Let those chains fall. Let fear get out of the way. Because our Lord is here and he changes everything. Jesus, you change everything. Chains.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ, the saving one. And we can see that God, you're moving a mighty river through the nations, and young and old will turn to Jesus. Fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. Do you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song, and all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness? And here we see that God, you're moving, a time of jubilee is coming, when young and old will turn to Jesus. Fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the down with singing. Songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice. And here we see that God, you're moving, a time of jubilee is coming, when young and old will turn to Jesus. Fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. Songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. Songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one.
Amen. Father God, Lord, just be with us as we go on through our weeks, God. Jesus, thank you for everything you have done for us, and thank you that it's not up to us and on our own strength, God, but we get to rely on your Holy Spirit. In your name, we pray, Jesus. Amen. Well, hey, thank you guys so much for joining us today. Again, if you're new here or I've never met you, my name's Isaac. I'm the youth pastor and groups director here, and I would love to get to know you in the lobby. But let me close with our great commission. Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the very end of the age." Go in peace, church. Have a great week.
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ.